Well, I hope that many of you are getting to know one another. That's the whole reason we do this, to encourage each other. It's very important, it's significant, I mean, to spend time with each other as the body of Christ. We live in a world that's very detached. We live in a world that's very busy. And I think it's important that we get to know who we're doing life with as a church family. I think it's extremely important. Just want to take a few moments. Met a couple here this morning. Some of you might know them. I don't really know them. I know her name is Sharon. She said she was like saved here 50 years ago. She used to go to the old building, and now here they were sitting back there. They just had to leave. And so Sharon's sister, I guess, is in the hospital, and they just got a text saying things are not looking good. And I forget her sister's name, but that's okay. God, the Lord knows. And so can we just take some time and pray for that situation? I don't know the details. That's all I know is what I just share with you. But God can meet that need, and God can do. Obviously, they just left in a hurry, and they were a little distraught. And so let's join our hearts together. So, Father, we just thank you for your church. We thank you for your body. We thank you that we do life together. When we rejoice, we rejoice with each other. When someone is hurting, God, we hurt with them. And so I pray for our brother and sister this morning who are just headed to the hospital. I don't even know really who they are, but they're headed to an emergency where this lady Sharon, her sister, is not in a good place right now with her health. It doesn't look good. And so, Father, we know that you're a God not limited by location. You're not here and can't be there. That's not who you are. You're everywhere, and you know what we're praying now. And so, Father, we invite you to do a work that needs to be done. And God, your will would be done in this situation. We pray you would provide peace. Lord, to Harold and Sharon, we pray that you would just take away any anxiety and fear and replace it with your love and with your grace, your peace. And so, Lord, we just ask that you would do a work that only you can do in this situation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. I always want to start off it's always good to look down and see your faces, and that's just not like, oh, I'm trying to win brownie points. I mean that, and you know what? We're believing that God is going to transform our lives, our church, our city. If we don't believe that, then why we even come? Why we even here? I mean, if we're it's like praying. Well, I'm going to pray, but God's not going to do it anyway. Well, then don't even pray then. I mean, what's the purpose to do things if you don't believe they exist or don't believe that God is able and willing to do the things that we ask? And so I really believe God is as his heart is to move forward. His heart is to see our city know him. And if we're on board with that, then God's blessing is going to be over us. If we're about ourselves, that's not the Lord's heart. The Lord's heart is that we be about him. And his heart is that lost people know who he is. And so I just encourage you, as you move about in your daily life, whether you're at school or at work or in your home, always be with that number one mission in your life. Always be about what Jesus is about. I mean, he came to seek and save the lost. And you have lost people in your life. And if you don't, come and talk to me and I'll introduce you to some. I'm new here. It's so important that we have people in our lives who don't know Jesus, right? I mean, that's what Jesus did. We read about it. He was always around people who didn't know his love. And that was his mission in life, was to express his love and let them know how much he loved them. And so we started this series last week called Believe. And we could call it something else. But believe as in a sense, what does it mean to believe in God? Because a lot of people, I mean, I've met people, I remember in just years ago, we would go downtown and give out tracts back in the day, 20, 30 years ago, or we'd do this, and you have conversation with people, oh yeah, I believe in God, but yet you would stand back and look at their life, and you would just go like, I don't understand. Like, you're living like the devil, but you say you believe Jesus. And so there's this misconception, I think, out there of what the word believe actually means. Even we quote verses. I talked to you last week about a guy who said, it doesn't matter how I live. I can live whatever way I want because the Bible says as long as I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm saved. I mean, there's a misunderstanding, I think, with this word believe, and that's what we want to talk about the next number of weeks, especially now when there's an openness to the things of Jesus, especially around Easter and Christmas. Many of your friends and family actually will hear you out. They actually might consider some of the things that you would want to talk to them about, because we were created. We were created in a way that we will never be complete or fulfilled unless Christ is in our lives. God created us that we cannot be fulfilled unless He's involved in our lives. And that's why so many people are seeking fulfillment. So many people are trying to search for whatever it is to fill that void, not knowing that all this time they're actually searching for the one who created them. And so it's very important that we help people discover Jesus. And so to help with that today, to help just understand how important it is to know why we believe and what we believe and what this word believe actually means, I was thinking about this example, and being new to Alberta, I think it's fantastic. Red Deer is located in such a great location. I mean, it's phenomenal. You got the mountains on one side, you got a major city north of you, and one south of you. I mean, and there's beauty all around us. I scratch my head sometimes and like, why aren't more people from Canada moving this way? Because it is incredible. It's beautiful. But I think a lot of people just don't know that it exists. A lot of people don't know. When they go vacationing, they go places that they can, you know, lay on the beach somewhere, or they go to places where their family is from, or they go to places where they grew up. And many times people don't travel this great country. And I think if they did and discovered, wow, Alberta is not at all like I thought it was. I was one of those. I just thought, there's no way I'm going to go west. I mean, why would I want to do that? And now I'm here. I'm like, man, this is an incredible province, beautiful land. And so just imagine with me that how many people are, would you say, anybody know how many people are in Edmonton? 1.3, is it, or 2 or 4? Anybody get approximately something like that? Same with Calgary, right? Maybe 1.2 or 3, something like that. So if you put both together, let's do the math. 1.3 plus 1.3. Let's just say it's 2.5 million people between two places. All right. Imagine that just 1.3 million of them, the people from Edmonton decided to go and join with the city of Calgary, or the people in Calgary decided to go and join the city of Edmonton. Can you imagine? We're right in the middle of them. Let's just imagine for a moment that there's no vehicles and there's no modes of transportation, and so the people in Edmonton need to walk to the city of Calgary, or the people in Calgary need to walk to the city of Edmonton, and we're in the middle of them. And all of a sudden, can you imagine if 1 million or 2 million people started walking through Red Deer? I mean, it's hard to imagine, but that would be overwhelming. Millions of people just moving through our city. I mean, it's a similar picture of what it was like when the Israelites were on the move, when they were walking through different places after they were freed from Egyptian slavery. About 2 million Israelites, they have to go on this journey and walk. That's a lot of people, 2 million people. What do we got here? Maybe 100 people? So times that by however many you got to times it by, 2 million people is a lot of people. So they were headed to a place, 2 million of them, led by a godly man named Moses. They're headed to a place called the Promised Land. They had only known slavery. Many of these people grew up. They were born into slavery. And now God decides to give them a promised land. God decides to say, if you do things my way, if you follow my commands, if you serve me as your God, then I will give you a land that you can call your own. I'll give you your own place. I mean, that's a lot of people to feed. Think about it. 2 million people walking, going on a journey, and it seemed overwhelming. So to make this move functional, to make this move capable of getting to destination, or from one point to the next point, God had to give these people some specific instructions about how to do that. God has to give them a plan. He lets them know what direction to go. He lets them know how to travel. When they're worrying about, you know, what about if my shoes wear out? He just, okay, don't worry about that. I'll take care of that. Or what are we going to do when we need food? God's like, I'll provide you food. As long as you follow my ways, I'll take care of you. And so 2 million people would go on this journey. And after they walk all day, they get to a point where they're exhausted. They're tired. I mean, I walk through the mall, I'm tired. They're walking all day, all right? All day through the desert heat and just they just can't stop and go to the fridge and grab a snack. I mean, it's hard. It's hard. And it's hard for me to imagine. But just think about it. They get to where they, you know, they walk all day and they get to, it's getting dark or it's getting evening and they have to set up camp. They just don't walk throughout the night. There's bandits. There's all kinds of animals. So they camp out every single night. So God even gives them instructions on how to camp out. There's that many people, so they have to kind of, you know, go on guard. They set up a group in the north. They set up a group in the south of 2 million people, east and west, okay? So just imagine that. There's like almost like a perimeter around these people, just taking care of everything. And so God gives them instructions. And right in the center of 2 million people, right in the middle of where they're camping, there's what they call the tabernacle. It's a portable structure where people gather to worship God. So they would travel all day, they would stop, 2 million people, they just set up camp, and right in the middle of the camp, they would set up the tabernacle to worship God, because God had to be at the center of this camp, right in the middle of their lives. There's something very important when you think about this. How does that relate to us today? Did you know that that was God's plan from the beginning, and still his plan today, that he would be at the very center of our lives. He would always be at the center of your life. You were designed to make Jesus the center of your life. You and I were never created that we would be the center of our lives, but we were created that he would be the center of our lives. That's how you and I were created. He's to be the center. God designed us, as I mentioned earlier, that he designed humanity in a way that unless he's the center, we will never really experience true peace or joy. And that's why so many of us, we've looked to everything to bring that joy. For some, it was drugs. For others, it was relationships. For others, it was seeking some sort of financial gain. For others, it was more about, you know, how we treat our bodies or how we look. I mean, we're always trying to fill what... And God's like, you will never find what it is you're trying to fulfill unless you understand that I need to be center of your lives. That's how God created us. And so what does it look like? The Bible says that we were created for God and by God. The Bible actually says that. You and I were created for God and by God. And so what does it look like then to have Jesus the center of my life? Remember that old song? I forget how it goes. Jesus be the center of my life? I don't know if that... Remember that? Anybody? Jesus be the center of my... Anybody? All right, well, I mean, that's... I mean, it's the... Okay, maybe nobody knows that song. Okay, fine. All right. Yeah. I don't know what song that is. Maybe that's one I made up in my head. I don't know. It means, yeah, to have Jesus the center of our lives means that he becomes the ultimate authority. To have Jesus the center of your life, to have Jesus the center of my life means that I freely surrender to him. Emphasis on that word freely. Think about it this way. If I were to demand something of you, if I were to say to you, give me that. No, give it to me. Then you are surrendering it to me, but you're not freely surrendering it. You're only doing it because I'm demanding you to give it to me. That's not how we serve God. That's not how we give our lives to God. Oh, well, I guess I have to. No. To give Jesus to have Jesus the center of my life is that I would freely surrender my life to him. It's a choice I make. He doesn't beg me and say, Bill, you must. But it's to give my life to submit to his authority and to freely surrender my life to him. And if I have to force any of you to give me something, then likely you're not freely surrendering it to me. Freely surrendering means I'm choosing to give it to you. See, God desires to be the center of you. God desires to be the center of me. And for Jesus to be the center of my life or your life, it means that he becomes the ultimate authority. He becomes priority. He becomes first. Because let's be honest, some of us, maybe even in this room, or some of us for sure watching online, Many of us, we think maybe that Jesus is the center of our life, but if we were to be honest and transparent, he's probably not first. He's probably not first because I've made myself first. And so that's not freely surrendering. Freely surrendering means Jesus is the center of my life. He's my priority. He's first. I no longer desire to independently run my life on my own. I run my life. Actually, I don't run my life. Jesus runs my life. And maybe you're here at this moment and you're thinking for, you're just saying, you know, why would I do that? Why? Like, I want to live my life the way I want to live my life. Like, why would I have someone else to be the authority of my life? Why would I surrender my life to anyone? Like, why would I do that? But that's just it, right? In our selfish, sinful nature, Satan by default is our authority. Because we were born into sin, Satan automatically becomes our authority. So it makes perfect sense not to surrender to anyone else's authority. Because that's my sin nature. And unless we identify or unless we understand that, I will always live. Like, we think sometimes, well, there's Satan's authority and God's authority. I think I'm going to sit somewhere in between. There is no in between. And so because I was born into sin, I sit under Satan's authority. And God is now inviting me into his authority. And so I get it. In today's culture, it's totally acceptable for me to think and feel that I can live my life the way I want to live it. But that's not how God created me to live it. God created me to live it for his kingdom, because Jesus is king. And so what does it mean to believe? Well, in Acts, remember, Paul says, believe on the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Well, again, it's more than just an awareness of God. To truly believe for me is to freely surrender and for me to understand that I come under King Jesus' authority. That's what it means for Jesus to be the center of my life. And so some were thinking, well, man, that's a big step. Yeah, it is a big step to have God make decisions for my life. That's huge. Because, I mean, the last time I checked, I kind of run my life the way I think is going to benefit me. But to have Jesus the center of my life is to say, God, what about you? What do you want me to do with my life? I encourage people who are trying to discover, because it's so tough. When you graduate high school, their pressure is on. Is maybe you understand exactly what I mean. You get out of high school and it's like, what do I do with my life? And we got guidance counselors telling us, oh, your marks, you're doing good in this over here. You should consider this for your life. Or someone else's, or maybe family, or maybe just culture is putting so much pressure. I know I felt the pressure. When I graduated high school, all my friends are like, they knew exactly what they wanted to do. At least it seemed like that. And I was just like, I have no idea. I know what I want to do. To be honest, I wanted to be a school teacher. That was my, so many things I did in life seemed to line up for me to go that direction. And yet I knew God wanted me to do this, and this was the last thing I wanted to do, was to have anything to do with ministry, per se. Pastoral ministry, last thing I wanted to do. But to have Jesus the center of my life, maybe for some of you, you need to understand, as you move out into a career, or if you're praying that God will provide you with a new job, listen, or you're like, what do I do with my life? God, what? If we can just understand, if we can just, okay, God, what do you want me to do with my life? See, to have Jesus the center of my life means that he makes decisions that's best for him. And it may not seem best for me, but in the long run, it's going to be best for me. Do you know how hard that is to live that way? When things seem to be moving in this direction and I feel like this is what I would enjoy in my life, but to step back from that and say, okay, God, what do you think though? Is this what you want me to do with my life? Is this the person you want me to be with? Is this the school you want me to go? Is this the career you want for my life? But that's what it means to have Jesus the center of your life, is that he has authority in my life. And he tells me what to do, and I don't tell him what to do. It was a conversation that Jesus was having with a man named Nicodemus. Anybody hear that name before? Nicodemus, John chapter 3. Got it for you on the screens here. Let me read this to you. Now, there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. So he was up there. I mean, he's a member of this ruling council. He's a somebody in that city or that town. People knew who he was. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher who has come from God. So we've kind of figured that out. For no one could perform the signs that you're doing if God were not with him." And Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." It's like Nicodemus is saying, "Listen, man, like, we know you must be from God because the signs and wonders that you're doing, no one else could do those things. You have to be from God." And it's almost like Jesus is saying, "Okay, I'm not concerned about signs and wonders. That's not, listen, this is bigger than that. This is about being born again. This is about the kingdom of God stuff. I know all that stuff is helpful and all that stuff and healings and signs and wonders, and you're telling me that I'm from God or I must be from God because I'm doing these things." And Jesus almost like changes the subject. It goes from signs and wonders to Jesus like, well, I tell you the truth, you can't even see the kingdom of God unless you're born again. And so Nicodemus responds, "Well, how can someone be born again? Duh. Like, when you're old, like, how is that even possible?" Like, Nicodemus asks, "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." He's not getting it. He's not understanding. And Jesus answers him, "Well, I tell you that no one can enter the kingdom of God," here he goes again, "unless they're born of water and the Spirit." Jesus said, "Flesh gives birth to flesh and spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised by me saying you must be born again." And so Jesus is having a conversation with this man named Nicodemus, a leading Jewish figure. I want to talk about him and why this is helpful. Maybe why this might be helpful for someone here who's living like Nicodemus, but understanding there's something more to life than what I've tapped into. So Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night. I don't know why. There's probably a lot of reasons. I mean, he comes to him at night because he's interested. He's like, there's something. I got to go and talk to this guy. Like, if anybody sees me talking to Jesus, I'm probably gonna, like, I don't know what they're gonna say to me. I don't know what. So I need to go at night. I don't want any of my other Pharisee buddies to know that I'm talking to Jesus one-on-one. Maybe that could be it. Or maybe night actually symbolized something different. Maybe a state of lostness. Or maybe that the night emphasized maybe more cold or the dark situation of his heart. Like, I don't know the significance. Either way, Nicodemus approaches Jesus and he acknowledges Jesus as rabbi. It's almost like he's like, "Hey, Jesus, I'm a rabbi, you're a rabbi. Let's have a rabbi to rabbi talk." And so they have this conversation. Why? That's the question. Why? There's something missing in Nicodemus' life. He's concerned. He's wondering. Maybe even conflicted. Because he's built his life on something completely different than what Jesus is teaching. When the masks are all off, and Nicodemus puts his head on his pillow at night, he's like, "What is it that I'm missing?" He knows that Jesus is offering something completely different. He knows something's missing in his life, but what could it be? And this teacher, this one they call Jesus, from God, as Nicodemus puts it, he has such authority. And I've never heard anything like that before. It's almost like Nicodemus is having this struggle. We have to understand, I just want to talk about a little bit about this, that to maybe understand that the battle that Nicodemus is having. He's a Pharisee, and the Pharisees believe that only Jews are going to inherit eternal life. Only Jews are going to enter the kingdom of God. They're thinking, you know what, as long as, if we're, first of all, we're born a Jew, and we believe in the resurrection. And so unless we stop believing, then we're automatically in. We're automatically in the kingdom of God. And they thought it didn't matter how you lived, as long as people thought you lived good. It didn't matter how your heart was. That's why there's somewhere in here where Jesus says, you know what, you're trying to clean the outside of the cup, but it's the inside that needs cleaning. And so the Pharisees were like, as long as people think we're kind of holy, as long as people think we're good with God, it doesn't matter how our hearts are. As long as we believe. And the Jews believed that they automatically inherit the kingdom of God if you were born a Jew. So Nicodemus would have been shocked. He would have been, his world would have been rocked when Jesus said, Nicodemus, unless you are born again, you're not entering the kingdom of God. That was completely different. In other words, Nicodemus, you're not going to see the kingdom of God unless you truly believe. There's this battle going on in Nicodemus, and Jesus' message is so stirring, so compelling, maybe even conflicting, because Nicodemus has built his way on a certain, he's built his life on thinking a certain way. Some of you were there. Some of you were raised in a certain way, and all of a sudden, one day, you discovered a relationship with Jesus Christ. Some of you understand exactly what I'm talking about. You heard about God. You would even say you believed in the big guy upstairs. But until that day came when you were like, you know what? There's something more to this. Nicodemus was where some of you used to be. He was taught to think a certain way about God. And so can you imagine the conversation he's having with himself saying like, God, I thought this is how it was supposed to be. And now Jesus is painting a different picture than I was taught. And so he's saying, I need to be born again. Matter of fact, John 3. Jesus replied, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they're born again. And it seems to go straight over Nicodemus's head. It's almost like, sure. I can't be born a second time of my mom. You want me to be born of my mother? And Jesus says, not physically, spiritually. You need to leave behind your past. Bible even says around this time is when Jesus started his earthly ministry and he begins to preach repentance for the forgiveness of sin. Jesus is like, you need to be born again. You need to repent. You need to get rid of the stuff in your heart. You need to be born into something new. At this moment, Jesus is trying to help Nicodemus understand that up to that point, his life was outside the kingdom of God, but now Jesus is trying to invite Nicodemus into the kingdom of God. Romans 3:23, very well-known verse, says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, including Nicodemus, who thought that by simply believing that God existed was good enough. Every one of us here, we've sinned. Every one of us falls short. All the time. We fall short. And if I'm not living my life for God, then Jesus clearly says, Nicodemus, hey, if you're not born again, you're not entering the kingdom of God. It's sobering to think, but these same words apply to every single one of us today. Unless we're born again, we're not seeing the kingdom of God. Unless we acknowledge, unless I'm born again, acknowledging Jesus as the center of my life. That's what to be born again means, is to give my life to Jesus, right? And I now live according to Jesus' way. Even in those decisions, even in those tough decisions, Jesus needs to be center of my life. And if I'm not living for Christ, then Jesus is asking you, he's asking me, just like he asked Nicodemus, you need to be born again. And it's more than just verbally saying a prayer and just living like my old self. It's way more than that. It's not just saying that prayer. Maybe that's a starting point, but it's living what you pray. How many here you've built your own house? Oh, yeah, several of you. Impressive. Some of you are building your own house. Yeah, some of you have built your own places. When I was 8, 9 years old, my dad built the house that we grew up in, and always just, I think it's amazing. I think it's so cool. I don't know what the headaches are like, you know, because you gotta get the material, and you gotta pull the permits, and you gotta do all that red tape stuff. But just imagine for a moment that I'm gonna build the house, okay? I'm gonna build a house somewhere here in Red Deer, and so I get the permits done, and I get the supplies, the materials, and I do all that stuff. And I approach you, and I say, listen, I'm building a house. I'm wondering if you can give me a hand. You're probably, because you're so nice, you might say, okay, sure. I mean, I'll check my schedule. I'll see when it works for me, and if I could get it off, I'll come and help you. I mean, So I approach and I ask for help, and yeah, it's my house. So but for you, it's like, it's not that big of a deal, right? It's like, it's the house that I'm building for. So for you, you're like, well, okay, all right, it's not that big of a deal. I'm excited for you, you know. But truly, you're not that excited. I mean, you're happy for me that I'm building a house, but you couldn't care less. I mean, you'll give a hand if you can. And so I'm building this house, and every now and then, maybe weekly, I call you up and I say, hey, listen, I just want to know, we just got the foundation poured this week. And you're like, woo, yeah, go Bill, you know. And then next week I call you up, yeah, we got the framing done and electrical's done. And you're just going like, yeah, right on. You hang the phone up and you're like, okay. Because you just, I mean, it's not your house, right? I'm building this house, I'm updating you, but honestly, you're not into my house building journey. And it's even hard to depend on you some days because, to be honest, your heart just really isn't into it. I mean, rightfully so, right? Probably because it's my house and not yours. Why would you be that interested? 10 months go by. Let's just say that was the time length that took me to build my house. And I call you up and I'm like, hey, listen, you want to go for coffee? And you're like, yeah, sure. No, why not? What do you need this time? Well, no, I don't need anything. The house is built. Okay, I don't need you to help. Like, no, let's go for coffee. So we go for coffee, and what happens next just shocks you. It floors you. I sit down and I say, hey, here's the key to your new house. Can you imagine in that moment? I mean, all along you thought I was building this house for me. But what I didn't tell you, I was actually building it for you. If you had known why I was building this house, it would have made all the difference, wouldn't it? You would have been so much more interested. You would have actually cared what kind of backsplash I put on that in that kitchen. But see, knowing why sometimes makes all the difference. Easter is just around the corner. And so maybe taking some time today to talk about what it means to believe, what it is to be born again, will actually help some of us, maybe even one of you here today, to have a greater understanding that what it's all about, that we would understand why Jesus did what he did. And we'll talk about that over the next number of weeks. Why did Jesus have to give his life? We know what he did because we celebrate it every Easter. We know that he came and he died on a cross and he was crucified and he was risen again. We know what he did, but sometimes we miss the why. We can't miss the why, because sometimes that why makes all the difference. He gave his life for us. It's about being born again so we can see the kingdom of God. And maybe like Nicodemus, some of you here, let's be honest, you need to be born again. I can make an assumption and look around this place and think, oh God, well, this message, you know, I don't know how that would go because everybody here is born again. I mean, that might be the assumption, but that may not actually be the case. Because I don't know where your heart is. But only God does. He knows. And so I'm not going to ask you as we spend some time over the next number of weeks. I just want to say this. It would be very important if you have somebody in your life who you've been praying for, if you would just invite them. Maybe they won't listen and have a conversation about spiritual things with you, but maybe they might come out on a Sunday morning because you've invited them, who would hear the good news that Jesus loves them. Maybe if they could understand why this all matters. Maybe you're in this place today and you would say, yeah, you know what, I get the Nicodemus part. I thought all I had to do was believe that God existed. But Jesus kind of raises the bar and he says, yeah, you know what, if you want to see the kingdom of God, Nicodemus, you got to go beyond that. You have to be born again. It's almost like Jesus saying, Nicodemus, I've got to be the center of your life. Just like the tabernacle when the Israelites walked through the desert and they would camp, you know, 2 million people right in the core, in the middle. is where they worshiped God. God had to be the center of that camp. And Jesus has to be the center of this camp, this home, this heart. And maybe you're here today, and if you were honest with yourself, I'm not going to ask you to be honest with me. I don't know what background you come from, but we don't invite people to come and confess sins to me. And then I talk to God for you. I'm going to let you know you have direct access to the Lord. And so it's not about you confessing anything to me, but being born again is about having that conversation with God. Have I allowed you to be the center of my life? Am I walking under your authority? Have I freely surrendered my life to you, Jesus? It's a short couple verses in the Bible, but this conversation with Nicodemus is powerful. Because all along, Nicodemus just thought, hey, I was raised in this. I just have to believe God's real, and that's it. And now Jesus says, hold on. You got to be born again. I have to be the center of your life. To be born again is to repent or turn from the sinful ways and the things that rob me of my joy, this thing that's coming under the authority of Satan, all these things. God says, I want to take over your life now, and I want to make decisions that's best for you, best for the kingdom. Being born again isn't about me going back to my old ways after I say some prayer to God, but it's me acknowledging my life to God and saying, I want you to be the center of my life, Lord. And I'm going to start making decisions that honor you. And I'm just going to start living my life the way that pleases you. Because it's so easy. Trust me, I live in the same world you live in. It's so easy to just hold on to this. Because this world, this culture that tells that we live in just tells us, listen, you need to live for you. I get it. I understand. It's so easy to just forget about God stuff and think, what is it I need to do today to bless myself or to live for me or to make myself happy? It's why we dress the way we dress. It's why we do our hair the way we do our hair. It's why we buy the stuff that we buy. It's because a lot of times we're trying to figure out what it is that makes me happy. Being born again is about It's about Him being pleased. It's about our Lord being pleased. It's about me submitting to His authority. Remember, you and I were created for Him. We know we were created by Him, because most every one of us here would say, yeah, I know God created me. But we got to take it a step farther and understand that Scripture also says we were created for Him. That's a whole sermon in itself right there. Well, we were created for Him because we must have Him the center of our lives. That's what it means to be born again. And so God was teaching the Israelites, no matter what, when you stop, when you go, I have to be the center of your life. I'll end with this verse or a couple verses. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, He asked His disciples, He said, what do people say? Like, who do people say that the Son of Man is? Like, what are they saying about me? And the disciples replied, well, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah, one of the prophets. And then Jesus says, but what about you? Because sometimes we answer God that way, right? By what someone else is thinking. Or yeah, I'm a Christian because I was raised in a Christian home. Or I'm fine the way I am because at least I believe in God. And Jesus, okay, I know what others are saying about me. They're saying I'm like maybe like Elijah or John the Baptist or a prophet or Jeremiah. And Jesus says, okay, I'm not really, that's what they think. But what do you think? What do you think? What do you say about me? Who do you say I am? It's probably a great question for each one of us here today to answer. Okay, Lord, who do I say you are? Man, I want to invite you in a moment here just to have that conversation with God. Lord, are you the Lord of my life? maybe we've assumed that he's the center of our life, but is he really the center of our lives, your life, my life? And I don't know that. That's only you. You know that. And Simon Peter said, well, Jesus, this is who I say you are. You're the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And I guess that's the question for each of us today. Is Jesus the center of my life? Have I been born again? Well, Jeremy leads us in a little time here of worship and song. I want to give you opportunity to have some of these questions with the Lord. Before you leave today, there's nothing magical about this building. These moments don't only need to happen here, but the location is not really that important, but the time is. And so many of us were like, I'll get around to it. And you may not have time to get around to it. So I want to give you an opportunity to have a conversation just between you and the Lord right now. To maybe ask those tough questions like Jesus asked his disciples, who do I say you are, Lord? Have you been a habit? Have you been a tradition? Have you just been something that I've casually walked through? Are you an afterthought? When things get really bad, then I come to you? Like, or are you the center of my life? It's a conversation worth having. And so as we take some time to sing this, I want to give you time to have that conversation. And if you do pray any sort of thing, then my encouragement is to live it. Maybe this is a significant moment for somebody in this place where you're going to say, you know what? I got to start living differently. That's what repentance is, right? Repentance is a change in direction. It's not going back to the stuff that I used to do, but it's Jesus being the center of my life now. Some of you may have to make some major changes. You may have to quit some things. You may have to stop doing some things. You may have to make some decisions differently. You may even have to change some people that you associate with that are just pulling you away from Jesus being the center of your life. Why don't you have a conversation and then we'll conclude our time together with a word of prayer. Are you the center of my life, Jesus? Because if he's not, you can change that today. And he can be.